Okay. Right, welcome to the sixth session of London Calling 2020, the online IASPM UK and Ireland blah, 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 conference. The sixth session, the theme is identity and theatricality, and we've got Stan Hawkins talking on the dandiest theatrics of Jacques Dutronc. And then afterwards, we've got Phil Auslander, Kion Hansen, and Freya Jarman, who are going to join him in a discussion. Just a couple of other announcements. On Thursday, we have Alejandro Postillo's Copla Cabaret. He's one of the papers is about this cabaret, and we've got a screening of it at 6 o'clock on Thursday. There'll be a Zoom invite sent out to all the registrants on via Eventbrite, and then Alejandro and Liz Pipe will be leading a discussion after that. And on Friday, Alex is going to lead his normal postgraduate and early career, well, postgraduate discussion group, the discussion group that anybody can go to on Friday afternoon at 4 o'clock. Again, the Zoom invite will go out later in the week. So, welcome everybody. Great to see so many people in the Zoom room. I'm going to ask everybody to switch their cameras and microphones off, and we can get started with Stan's keynote, and then Freya's going to lead the discussion with the group afterwards. Okay, so I'll see you later, everybody.
Simon, should I introduce Stan just before we get started? Or afterwards, I don't mind.
Afterwards, why don't
okay, that's fine.
Yeah. Okay.
I would like to start by thanking Simon Zagorski-Thomas and the organisers of this conference for inviting me to hold a keynote address today. This branch of IASPM holds a particularly special place in my life, having provided an important launching pad for a career in popular music research. In the early 1990s, when I took over from Simon Frith as UK chair for this very association, I had just helped start the first degree courses in popular music and recording at Salford University. In retrospect, IASPM also directly led to my taking up a post at Oslo University in 1995 to start up popular music courses there, where I have been employed ever since. My presentation today has given me cause to bind together a number of concepts that have been loosely banded around in the field of popular music studies up to now. Theatricality, the persona, gendered subjectivity, masculinity, authenticity, and the spectacle. My approach is interdisciplinary and intercontextual. And in the main, I have endeavored to weave together ideas from my earlier work on identity in popular music. I hope my introduction to Jacques Dutronc, one of France's most revered rock stars and film actors, will be as much fun for you as a reminder that pop theatricality really matters and can account for our own cultural, social, and political state of affairs today.
Avec ma vie, mon petit schéma, mon mal de tête, mon boîte au foie, j'y pense et puis j'oublie. C'est la vie, 80.
Theatricality in popular music is a phenomenon of live and recorded performances where action establishes a significant sense of drama. Derived from the Greek theomeia, literally to see, theatre refers to the dramatic performance as a branch of art appealing to all the senses. Theatricality impacts the spectator in ways that may be surprising, delightful, inspirational, entertaining, or downright annoying. In music, this is rendered in the form of singing, dancing, and playing instruments. Inextricably linked to theatricality is the matter of the persona, derived from the word mask in Latin, which pertains to the intentional theatrics of social role-playing. In popular music studies, theories around the persona abound, which are often linked to the much-debated question of authenticity. Generally, scholars recognize that our experience of a song is directed to the singer's own subjectivity as we interact with them as observers. The process of becoming acquainted with a performer inevitably involves fathoming out their characteristics. And this transpires through intricate processes of listening and viewing. As songs are staged, they are conditional on establishing points of communication, where a myriad of factors come into play that inform our impressions. No doubt reactions to artists remain multiple and variable, influenced by the environment of fellow songwriters, lyricists, band members, sound engineers, producers, and directors. I would like to suggest that the persona is a vital part of an artist's lived subjectivity and a means to survival in the music industry. A useful way to think about theatricality in popular music is via the establishment of the musical persona, where we can distinguish between the real life and narrative persona. Philip Auslander, in his concept of the musical persona, claims, quote, "There is no reason to suppose that musicians perform the same identity when playing music as in their other life routines. The version of self that a musician performs qua musician is what I am calling the musical persona." This is from Auslander's forthcoming book, In Concert, Performing Musical Persona, to be published by the University of Michigan Press. Auslander has an earlier work suggested that it is the notion of vocal realism that ultimately belies the stage personality. And Laurie Burns has shown how first-person narration often results in the listener conflating both narrator and protagonist. In such an instant, the listener might confuse these two roles, even when the I who narrates is distinct from the I whose experience is projected. Burns goes on to insist in her chapter contribution to Sounding Up Pop, quote, "A popular music listener has expectations for vocal expression that are dependent on the genre as well as the gender of the artist. The gender of the voice cannot be set aside or bracketed." Consistent with these ideas, I have been mindful of the role of personal narratives, where artists recount their own life circumstances. A personal narrative is a powerhouse of address where artists express themselves in the narrative reconstitution of the self through an open-ended process of reflection and revision. John Richardson and I once theorized this, stating, quote, "Personal narratives, then, are performative. They pertain not only to what we tell, but how we tell and act. Moreover, they are subject to the same forces and constraints that inform all interpretative acts." One might say they disclose the features of a sonic environment as well as the personic. In other words, pop artists stage themselves by understanding their own narratives at the same time they stage their function as protagonists in their songs. Into this debate flows a range of tricky features. including the understanding of address and perception. And inevitably, there is the question of authenticity of expression. Auslander makes the salient point. Quote, popular musicians do not perform their personae exclusively in live and recorded performances. They also perform them through the visual images used in the packaging of recordings, publicity materials, interviews, and press coverage, toys and collectibles, and other venues and media, including music video. Identifying with personas involves working out the strategies invested by performers as they stage themselves to the world. In pop music, critical interest in the persona is evident in the work of numerous scholars. Simon Frith has stressed that layers of interpretation are often taken for granted when listening to songs, and because of this, performance, composition, and personas are wide open to interpretation. Invariably, artists address their own personas not only in their musical performances, but also in their offstage interviews, where the game of masking and theatricality is often normalized. Here follows a snippet from Orville Peck, the inimitable queer country singer who is keen to stress the relevance of realness in his aesthetic, maintaining his persona is not that distinct from his personal narrative. He is known for his fringed Lone Ranger mask, which is derived from the fictional Lone Texas Ranger, who fought for law and order in the American Old West. Notably, Peck's personal narrative is revealed by him stating vehemently that he doesn't talk about his masks in depth, as he wants people to have their own take on it. I don't want to lay it out and pin it down. I just don't think that's important.
I am Orville Peck, I think a misconception about me is that because I have an aesthetic or whatever people want to call it, that somehow what I do is something cultivated or something kind of, it's like there's something kind of synthetic about it or whatever. But, you know, to me, I grew up, especially the country musicians that I grew up loving, they all, you know, had very heavy aesthetic attached to them. And I kind of think that, you know, my definition of kind of classic country music is like the crossroads between sincerity and, you know, like drama or performance or boldness or camp or whatever you want to call it. If you look at someone like Porter Wagoner or even, you know, Johnny Cash or of course Dolly Parton or, you know, I mean, those people were like larger than life personalities, and some of them wore essentially what are costumes or, you know, kind of performance pieces, but the music they wrote had, you know, like a lot of sincerity behind it and a lot of, you know, the themes of common and country, you know, heartbreak and loss and whatever, but they're done through, you know, what I guess people could maybe interpret as a gimmick, but I think that that is a long lineage of country. And so for me, what I do is I write really sincere songs about my personal experiences and where I've lived and where I've traveled and people I've met, and I do it with, you know, some flair and artistry attached to it because I'm a, you know, like I'm a country western musician, and that's just what I want to, how I want to do it. So for me, I think it's misinterpreted sometimes that what I do is kind of insincere or maybe just like a character or a shtick or whatever, but I don't see it like that at all. You know, I just am Orville Peck and these are my stories.
Thinking about personas and alter egos draws attention to the painstaking strategies invested by performers as they stage themselves to the world. In popular music research, critical interest in this has increased in the past years. In keeping with Frith and many others, Alan Moore has considered notions of the persona separation between categories of performer, composer, and protagonist, developing a model that probes at the aspects of the persona. Moore highlights the distinctions of the persona in terms of their real-life status and the fictive roles they negotiate within the parameters of a song. Entering from another direction, Keith Negus has insisted on an intermediate position that is sensitive to the idea of intercontextuality, where data is retrieved in the processes that move constantly from individual to collective. One method here could be to bridge the intersubjective aspects of values, social encounters, histories, and institutions with the artist, their persona, in an intercontextual dialogue. Because personas are neither construed nor sustained within or outside any one single text, they operate buoyantly. Accordingly, they are continuously reinvented, retold, and repositioned through the convergence and divergence of texts, all of which mounts to the spectacle. Particularly relevant is Guy Debord's seminal work, Society of the Spectacle, which became the prime launching pad for the situationist movement, outlining a Marxist critical theory. The act of détournement, literally meaning hijacking or rerouting in French, was employed to establish subversive pranks that were political. An influential tactic was epitomized by the punk movement in the 1970s and later the anti-consumerist social movements in the 1980s that subverted mainstream cultural institutions. On the 1983 edition of Debord's book, the iconic cover by Ayerman for Life magazine literally speaks volumes, depicting a passive audience engrossed in the first showing of the film Buona Devil. This, the first color 3D natural vision film shown in 1952, conjures up the act of immersion or absorption in spectatorship. I would like to suggest that the spectacle is integrated into the complex correlation and staging of audiovisual features prevalent in all recorded performances. Generally, recording engineers, directors, and producers are largely responsible for the oral constructedness of the performance. As such, they aid the musical personae, blurring the divisions between the real and fictional self. Illusions of who the artist is has everything to do with theatricality and the playing out of roles in the cultural sphere. Moreover, the theatricality of recorded performances in popular music is a result of performers conceiving their personae from one song to the next and calculating what this means to an audience. The clip in this slide shows the London-based songwriter and music producer Acacia Kay bringing together all the elements that contribute to developing a track in the recording studio. In the discussion that follows, I am particularly eager to pull the curtain on the spectacle of musical performance, demonstrating how the audiovisual recording exposes ideals that are generative, imitative, and self-fashioned. With this in mind, let's delve into the staging of the persona and the implications of vocal expression. Granted, the mediation of the persona through the voice can be identified in countless ways. In my work, I have been keen to focus on its structuring in direct relation to gendered identity, fully accepting that in every performance situation, different personas surface on the basis of the individual's experience and propensity for interpreting style and context. Pop dandyism, which I have theorized through a study of British popular music, is one way to understand how staging the persona works in relation to masculinity, slotting into a long history of icons of fashion. So over to France now, as good a place as any, to consider dandyism and how revolutionary events gave rise to the emergence of new identities, where often the eccentric display of the individual became a resistance to the reactionary. Like their British counterparts, French dandy figures exhibited the spirit of the time. Beau Brummel, and later on the foppish Oscar Wilde we know, intrigued the French as le dandyisme became integrated into parts of the community. Forerunners of French dandyism, Charles Baudelaire and Jules Bobby de Ravilly, sought inspiration from the alien temperament across the channel, as Anglomania fused ideologies and attitudes on the continent. By 1952, another wave of dandies had taken France by storm. Mainly a British teen subculture of young men, the Teddy Boys, with their attitude and quasi Savile Row tailored attire, drew their style from the dandies of the Edwardian period. In fact, the Teddy Boy was a shortening of Edwardian to Teddy, coined by the Daily Express in the early 1950s. Also, there were the Teddy Girls, whose clothes style included tailored jackets that were coupled with pencil skirts, and later American poodle skirts, rolled-up jeans, and flat shoes or espadrilles. Touches could include straw boater hats or elegant clutch bags. The teddies and the mods formed much of the cultural landscape for the emergence of Jacques Dutron, born in Paris in 1943 and one of the most revered French singers of all time. Possessing a defined Parisian mod air, Dutron would often be photographed smoking a cigarette in a Renoma suit and tie. One of the first artists to signal the grand entry of rock music into France, he has been described as le dandy cool and the first French rock artist who was not a carbon copy of an Anglo-American artist. Dutron broke with the tradition of the French chanson by a pioneering approach to singing. His self-entitled debut album turned him into one of the best-selling French stars of the 1960s and 1970s, topping 6 million sales. While his second single, Les Playboys, sold 600,000 copies, remaining in top chart position for 6 weeks. The official video of Les Playboys holds a vital clue to what the French felt about popular music from the other side of the channel. Four Beatles look-alike lads sit behind a table, banging out the song's hook, while Dutron, poised and also seated, looks on, smoking a cigarette. In the refrain, he moves from a sung-spoken style to a warbled crooning on a melody in descending motion to accent his condescending stance. The staging of his persona in the video discloses a strategy of seduction through playfulness and a laid-back, sedentary disposition. Indeed, a high dose of nonchalance works in the form of humorous retort, which is regulated by Dutron's style of singing that is wry in its shouting-like nature. Note the actor second from the left, who coincidentally or not, has an uncanny likeness to Paul McCartney.
Il y a les playboys de profession habillés par Cardin et chaussés par Charlie. Qui roulant Ferrari à la place comme à la ville, qui vont s'écarter comme ils vont s'effaucher.
Croyez-vous que je sois jaloux? Pas du tout.
Sa fille, un piège tabou, un joujou extra qui fait craque-boum-hu. Les filles en tombent à mes genoux. J'ai pas peur des petits minets qui mangent leur ronron au drugstore. Ils travaillent tout comme les castors, ni avec leurs mains, ni avec leurs pieds. Les filles en tombent à mes genoux. Je ne crains pas les costauds, les supermen, les bébés aux carrures d'Hatchet. Aux yeux d'acier, au sourire coquet, en Harley Davidson, ils se promènent.
croyez-vous que je sois jaloux? Pas du tout, pas du tout.
Moi, j'ai un piège à fille, un piège tabou, un joujou extra qui fait craquer mon cul. Les filles en tombent à mes genoux.
Philip Auslander has discussed how the Beatles in the mid-1960s possessed a collective identity of a cheerful, user-friendly, slightly irreverent boy band. But by 1967, however, 1 year after Dutron's Les Playboys had been released, their persona as a group had changed considerably, influenced by the countercultural ethos of the time. Throughout the Les Playboys video, there is an element of indifference as Dutron targets an approving audience in a calm and relaxed manner. Mod-influenced, his look is contrasted by the robotic and silly-like gestures of the four boys, their hand claps, gestures, and smirks. Strikingly handsome, Dutron assumes center stage, reinforcing normative constructions of masculinity that are mapped onto the narrative. There's little short of contempt for the playboys who career around in their sports cars with glamorous girls by their side. Do you think I am jealous, he sings, the slick, sophisticated look that involved tightly fitting tailor-made suits with narrow lapels, thin ties, button-down collar shirts or cashmere jumpers. The hairstyles of mods everywhere were derived from an aesthetic of the La Nouvelle Vague, was a social, political, and cultural awareness that meant their productions dealt with working class matters. This is brilliantly captured in another song, Hippie Hippie Hurrah, where Dutron is filmed awkwardly alongside female dancers in what seems to be a complete spoof on hippie culture. Dutron, now in the role of a hippie, smirks, recoys, and parodies the hippie movement of San Francisco in terms of dance and lines that ooze contempt. Je suis hippie, c'est ma nouvelle philosophie, hip hip aura, vive le macrota. Dutron is so overcool in his demeanor that he almost passes out.
Je suis hippie, c'est ma nouvelle philosophie. Hip hip hip, hurrah, vive le moukoutra. Je suis hippie, c'est ma nouvelle philosophie. Hip hip hip, hurrah.
Fashion is a structuring tool in the construction of the pop dandy, and in tandem with musical personae, it can expose social class, gender, and politics. Historically, the shaping of masculinity through a mod sensibility signified a major development in London and Paris during the swinging 60s. Dutron's dandiest traits are discernible in a mocking-like conceit and contrived vulnerability. I would argue that his brand of dandyism is theatricalized as he heaps scorn on the Beatles' lookalikes in Les Playboys. In line with the French dandies of the 19th century, an underlying contempt for bourgeois society is made apparent in his mod style. Albert Camus stated in his book-length essay, L'Homme Révolté, translated as The Rebel from 1951, the dandy is by nature always in opposition. While Charles Baudelaire took up the politics of aesthetics, in this his famous quote, from the painter of modern life. The specific beauty of the dandy consists particularly in that cold exterior resulting from the unshakable determination to remain unmoved. One is reminded of a latent fire whose existence is merely suspected, and which, if it wanted to, but it does not, could burst forth in all its brightness. My position on theatricality is quite aligned to Serge Lacasse's theorization of the staging of the recorded voice, where vocal manipulations give way to connotations and effects. While Lacasse employs vocal staging to designate any deliberate practice whose aim it is to enhance a vocal sound, alter its timbre, or present it in configuration with the help of any mechanical or electric process, I am eager to extend this to audiovisual staging by bringing gender more to the foreground. Dandyism is invariably coded by sartorial subtlety and twisted self-ridicule, and the link between fashion and music is dependent on an embarrassment invested into the subversive act of expressing oneself. In particular, it is the animation of vocal expression derived from articulation, compulsion, recording, and production techniques that defines the artist's identity. Laurie Burns has argued that musical strategies can bring the artist closer to us or, conversely, establish a sense of distance. Quote, "Thus, the artist can be felt to be inside the listener's consciousness or at a social distance. In fact, artistic authority ascribes to the personal and communal in addition to the more traditional authorial narrative mode." On this note, I'm going to turn to Dutron's Les Cactus from 1967, which the majority of Frenchmen of his generation know well. This is the third track from his debut album, sold 400,000 copies, reaching number 4 in the French charts during March 1967. On first impression, the song is structured simply. The instrumental lineup is guitars, kit, bass, percussion, and piano organ, while the form is in a 12-bar blues structure, with drums and vocals alone together at the commencement of each cycle. Dutron's voice chronicles the technologies behind record production over 50 years and their profound impact on pop aesthetics. As many have argued, the pop aesthetic derives from an artificial context that is made to feel real, which indeed becomes a new site for authentic location and identification. And in the mix, vocal temperament, I want to argue, is a major ingredient of theatricality. Let us take a listen to part of this video now.
Le monde entier est un cactus, il est impossible de... Dans leur
Dutronc's recorded voice chronicles the technologies behind record production over 50 years, and his aesthetic derives from an artificial context that is made to feel real, which indeed becomes a site for authentic location and identification. In the mix, vocal temperament is a major ingredient. In Dutronc's performance of Les Cactus, levels of vocal intimacy are inextricably linked to how the vocal part is recorded. We might consider vocal costuming as the prime carrier of identity that gets us to feel in close touch with them. Much of this is due to the theatricality captured by the recording, which is staged in a way that makes the performance feel live and natural. Indeed, the recording of Les Cactus, and not least the video, gives the impression of being at a live event. The recording reveals also the staging of temperament. Contemplating just the first of the several 12-bar cycles, a wealth of details surface that expose vocal expression. Note how Dutronc's voice is animated raucously as he shouts at the end of each cycle, and in so doing, he exerts a high degree of vocal compulsion to extract his emotions. In every 12-bar cycle, the intensity builds up to excitable shouts that become literally exclamation marks. All this is integral to his musical persona, which is an angry man cursing the world. In the second transcription, you will note I have circled the shouted vowels that are common to French, which are used as major punctuation marks at the end of each 12-bar cycle. I would further suggest that non-verbal sounds disclose the singer's propensity for musically painting his persona and articulating his set of aesthetics.
Le monde entier est un cactus. Il est impossible de s'asseoir. Dans la vie, il y a des cactus. Moi, je me pique de le savoir. Aïe, aïe, aïe. Aïe, aïe.
In working out what is happening vocally, I have turned to two sonograms, greatly inspired by Laurie Burns, who gave a keynote earlier on at the same conference. The first involves a rebalance processing function of the isotype RX software, which is an algorithm that modifies the volume of different categories of sound, voice, bass, percussion, guitar, and keyboards. In rebalancing the riff, it's possible to position the voice at a very audible level with stripped back instrumentation. In the second sonogram, the information is in full as we hear and see how the voice works alongside the instrumentation and how relevant rhythm and melodic and harmonic parameters are in theatricalizing Dutronc's voice. The illustration draws attention to the remarkable density of timbre and texture in the staging of the recorded performance. The purpose of both these sonograms is to bring to the fore the minute traits of Dutronc's vocal expression and compulsion, exemplifying the point that each 12-bar riff culminates in a vocal intensity that is governed by abrupt shouts and exclaims.
Le monde entier est un cactus. Il est impossible de s'asseoir. Dans la nuit, il y a des cactus. Moi, je me pique de le savoir. Aïe, 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 aïe. Le monde entier est un cactus. Il est impossible de s'asseoir. Dans la nuit, il y a des cactus. Moi, je me pique de le savoir.
I would emphasize that the visualization of sound also holds an important clue to the functioning of temperament. In the following frames that end the video, it's apparent that Dutronc has a great deal of fun, fooling around in the role of a bullfighter who fights a cactus rather than a bull. All the gestures here are more exaggerated and parallel the build-up in musical material. Here we can see how vocal costuming heightens the intensity of physical movements in a bid to spectacularize and aestheticize. In concluding, I want to suggest that theatricality is a recalibration of everyday life, where the convergence of styles and idioms in the 1950s and 1960s gave credence to the popular music and cultural traditions in existence today. Forging masculinity through a mod sensibility in the 1960s symbolized a quest for an identity that ultimately became institutionalized. If Serge Gainsbourg was the Leonard Cohen of French pop music, then Jacques Dutronc was the cool mod dandy, the Gallic Bob Dylan. He was part of La Nouvelle Vague, a precursor to the political and social upheavals of the 1960s. His expressive singing and performance style encapsulated a sense of anti-establishment that was framed by the growing civil unrest in Paris in 1968. The student uprising, street battles, mass protests, and national strikes that would transform France forever, uniting intellectuals and manual workers. The women's liberation movement, LGBTQ rights, and anti-racist legislation grew out of this. Dutronc's cult of the self can be seen as a rebellion, his vitality symptomatic of the pop esprit of Paris, which found a resonance in the Beatles, Ray Davies, Mick Jagger, David Bowie, and many others. In popular music studies, we have come a long way in complementing the scholarship of major opera, film, and musical scholars. Susan McClary, Gary Tomlinson, Larry Kramer, Nicholas Cook, Freya Jarman, Claudia Gorbman, Joseph Kerman, and many others. As a means to understand how personae in rock, pop, and other idioms function as powerful arbitrations of the natural as much as the artistic. 100 years before Dutronc released Les Cactus, Baudelaire had this line in his poem, Anywhere Out of the World, N'importe où du monde, published in 1867. It always seems to me that I should feel well in the place I am not. It's on these words I land in a bid to emphasize the significance of theatricality in recorded performances in these ever-increasing, uncertain times.
Mini moque et mini jupe, mini moche et lilliput. Il est mini docteur Schweitzer, mini mini.
Thanks so much, Stan. That was amazing. I don't know if you can see the chat, but everybody else is saying exactly the same, that it's fabulous and fascinating and terrific, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not sure whether Simon was going to join us at exactly this point, but I think it probably behooves me to introduce those of us who will respond in the first instance. I'm sure that others will have questions. I saw one emerging already in the chat here. But just to sort of transition us really to the more sort of discursive part of all of this, Stan, I was going to introduce you before. You need very little introduction. It's my delight nonetheless to give you one. As Professor of Musicology at the University of Oslo and the University of Agder in Norway, Stan has, as many of you will know, published very widely on popular music, particularly in areas of culture, sexuality, identity, And his list of publications would no doubt have us here all night. But of course, notable for this evening are his books, The British Pop Dandy, Queerness in Pop Music, Prince, The Making of a Pop Music Phenomenon, and so on. You've also, of course, served as chair of UK IASPM and Northern IASPM, so I imagine this is feeling like lovely home turf for you. Also discussing this presentation, we have Philip Auslander, who's a professor in the School of Literature, Media and Communication at Georgia Tech. Among many, many other things, he's author of Liveness, Performance in a Mediatized Culture, and also Performing Glam Rock, Gender and Theatricality in Popular Music. And of course, Stan made reference to Phil's forthcoming and very recent text in this field. I'm delighted to be in the same virtual room as Phil, whose work I've read over many years and taught as well. The final among us is Kiana Hansen. If you can give everybody a wave, Kiana, thank you very much. As Associate Professor of Music at the Department of Arts and Cultural Studies at the Inland Norway University of Applied Sciences, which is too many words for one institution. I met Kiana as Stan's PhD student, and he's written many brilliant pieces on contemporary pop personae, particularly through the lenses of race and gender. He's written on Beyoncé, Zayn Malik, post-boy band masculinity. I've been very delighted to be working with Kiana recently another colleague of ours on a fest drift of essays inspired by Stan's work that's coming out in this August. So that's all of us. I don't know which one of us might like to respond first. I certainly have some things to say, but Phil or Kiana, if you have something you'd like to start with, I'd be delighted.
Okay, I'm happy to. Whoops.
Cool.
Okay, so wait. First of all, let's do this. I just want to say how happy I am to be involved in this. Thanks so much for the invitation. Secondly, I want to say Stan already knows how happy I am that he's bringing Jacques Dutronc into the conversation. I spent parts of my childhood in France, so I am already familiar with Jacques Dutronc. And in fact, one of my prized possessions is this. Jacques Dutronc's first EP that came out in 1966, his very first release. So I've been aware of him for quite a long time. And so now I'm going to put my notes on the screen. So I don't know where you'll see me looking, but anyway. I think broadly speaking, I agree with pretty much everything Stan said. I think he did a really, really nice job of kind of encapsulating some of the major discourses that define Dutronc's persona, particularly dandyism indeed and the mod phenomenon. And I think that's exactly right, that Dutronc certainly counts clearly as a French version of both of those things in combination. I think what I would like to add to that, or really maybe in a sense just stress a bit more than Stan did, because it's in what Stan said, he has this quotation, the dandy is always in opposition. And he also talks a little bit about the elements of self-ridicule and embarrassment that make up a dandy persona. And I'd like to underline those things a little bit, because I think that, yes, Dutronc is definitely in opposition in certain ways to aspects of French culture, which I'll talk about more in a second. In opposition to trends in pop music of his time, although obviously he embraces some other trends. But I think the important point for me is that he also presents himself as being in opposition to the way he presents himself, right? When I watch Dutronc's videos, I'm always thinking about Irving Goffman's concept of role distance. Which involves playing a role, but playing it in such a way that it's a kind of meta communication that tells your audience that you do not wish to be identified with this role. And I think that Dutronc does that all the time. And for me, the two ways that this comes out most visibly or audibly in one case are the way that he moves, and I noticed in the chat that Simon made the point that his presence on screen is much less energetic than the song you hear him perform. And that's exactly right. I mean, the way that he moves consistently in these videos is very low energy, very uncommitted. I mean, the way that I think about it is that pretty much all of his gestures are one way or another, kind of the equivalent of a shrug, right? Which basically makes it harder to take seriously what he's saying, because he doesn't really seem to take it all that seriously himself, right? So the other thing I just wanted to put on the table also has to do with the lyrics to these songs. Now, one thing that's worth mentioning is that Dutronc did not write the lyrics to these songs. They were written by a guy named Jacques Lanzmann, who was a French literary figure with a very interesting history in his own right. So one thing I want to say, therefore, is that to the degree that the lyrics help to define Dutronc's persona, which I think they do, I think they actually play a very large role. I mean, Stan used the phrase to describe him, an angry man cursing the world, which again is true, but at the same time, Dutronc both performs that role and distances himself from that role. But to the extent that there is anger, there is cursing the world, that's not, of course it's in the music, but it's also in the lyrics. So I do want to talk a little bit about the lyrics to these songs. I'll just talk about one song, which I think Stan may have had a little clip of it, which is from my EP called Mini, Mini, Mini. And it's sort of a social satire on the miniaturization of culture that sort of takes off from the mini skirt and what Dutronc calls the minibus, which would have been a VW microbus in my country. And it kind of uses this as a way of perhaps, a plausible reading is, a way of sort of talking about the smallness of French culture and society. I mean, the first lines are petit, 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 right? Tout est mini dans notre vie. But the thing about the song is that it involves an incredible amount of wordplay, right? So any word that has mini in it finds its way into this song. So whereas, you know, mini jupe, mini skirt, mini bus, microbus, okay, so these are cultural artifacts of the time. But then later in the lyrics, words like ministère, minister, come in, which, so what's that got to do with anything? Except perhaps there's some vague notion of introducing a political element, but I think the real reason the word ministère is there is because it has mini in it, right? And then that line is ministère et terminus. And there's no reason for the word terminus to be in there as part of some kind of social satire, except of course it fits perfectly formally because ministère ends with ter and terminus begins with ter, and terminus has a mini in the middle of it, right? And then in the second part of the song, after Dutronc says, je préfère les maxi, I prefer maxi to mini, he goes back through those same lyrics and changes all the minis to maxis, right? So mini stale becomes maxi stale. And terminus becomes ter maxus. And of course, these are non-existent words, right? It's all pure sort of formalistic wordplay. It's very funny and it's extremely smart and clever. But I also think it tends to, it's a kind of reductio ad absurdum, ultimately, that tends to intentionally undermine whatever sort of cultural or political critique the words themselves might hint at, because the song ultimately seems to be much more, the lyrics ultimately seem to be much more about this kind of very, very ingenious wordplay and construction than they are about anything else. And this is true of a great many of the songs that Dutronc performed with Lanzmann's lyrics. I would note, I'm going to stop talking in a second, but I would note that on my EP, on the song credits, Lanzmann actually is the first name in the credits and Dutronc is the second name. And in that sense, I would say that although it's very tempting to want to view Dutronc, you know, as a kind of singer-songwriter type, a Dylan or, you know, whatever, That's not quite the case, because of course the big difference between Dutronc and someone like Dylan or Leonard Cohen or even Serge Gainsbourg is that Dutronc is a performer and a composer, but he's not a lyricist, right? So that content is coming from another place. And as I said at the outset, that content is, you know, I think very, very key to the construction of Dutronc's persona and our understanding of it and the perspective it represents. I'm not saying anything new in suggesting that therefore Dutronc's persona, you know, is the work of many hands, right? It's not created just by him, but by other creative people who have input into the songs and so forth. Okay, so I will stop there.
Thanks so much, Phil, that was marvelous. Stan, do you wanna respond to that at all?
I would love to just add one thing to what Phil said, and that's that when it comes to the lyrics, there's also this stylistic idiom within French rock stars singing French, but also English at the same time. And it's this yaourt effect where English is often imitated and words that come from English are used in what's described as a fake way in a kind of attempt to parody also the stylistic influences from sort of the Anglo-American area. And I think it's the way in which when he does use English words within a French context and exaggerates them and puts particular accents on them, that also contributes enormously to this kind of humorous intent that he has. Thanks very much for those great comments. I mean, there's a few books to be written on Dutronc. And as you know, and we should actually tell everyone at this conference, it's really revealing how little material one can find written on Dutronc. A book has recently come out called Made in France, and it's by Guibert and another editor. And there's three references to Dutronc, one to his son, and they are just more or less in passing, yeah. Which is quite astonishing, considering what an icon he is actually in France. So that's also something that needs to be potentially problematized.
Thanks so much. Kayana, let me bring you in. What were your thoughts that you would like to share?
Thanks, Freya. First of all, Stan, thank you very much for an excellent keynote presentation. It was thoroughly enjoying, as always, when it comes to your presentations. And thanks also to Simon for inviting me to participate in this event. I think I'm going to keep with the point of Jacques Dutronc to stay with the case study for a little bit, because I really enjoyed your perspectives on his dandy persona, Stan. You say that he was, or I would want to raise 2 points, if that's okay. I can go through them quite quickly and let you respond to the first one first before I move on to the second. You say that he was probably the first French dandy who was considered not a carbon copy of an Anglo-American artist. And I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit on this point, perhaps focusing particularly on the musical aspects of staging a dandy persona in a French setting as opposed to a British one.
Absolutely. We know the sheer impact of Anglo-American rock music on the whole of Europe and all European countries, not least Norway, where we are both stationed. And there has been a tendency to imitate and kind of reproduce, even language-wise, an American or British kind of persona or personality. And that's kind of what I was referring to, is that there were lots of bands that were formed during this period in France that, you know, weren't seeking to necessarily become famous or successful, but were just immediately imbibing the Anglo-American influence. So he kind of stands out as someone who inherited lots of influences. And I noticed that Sarah Hill reference Ray Davies, which is one of the biggest influences, but he still came in with something that was distinctly French. And that was more or less the point I was making there.
Yeah, I guess language plays a big role here. Yeah,
language plays a very important part. And language is culture. So there are also, you know, other things going on there, as Phil has brought in as well.
Mm. There are musical idiosyncrasies to languages as well, one might argue, I guess.
Yes, and also, the way French people will shout and actually exclaim in certain vowel sounds is different. You know, there's a lot of ois going on, which aren't quite the same sort of sound that you would probably get from someone in Liverpool, you know?
Hmm. I think the second point I'd like to raise, while I have the mic, so to speak, I'd be interested in exploring the point that masculinity functions relationally as well, in the sense that it is shaped partly by relations of dominance and subordination with women and with other men as well. And Raven Connell has discussed this in detail in her foundational work on hegemonic masculinity. In the Le Playboy and Hippie Hippie Hurrah videos, Dutronc quite clearly stands apart from the other people involved, which is also regulated musically, of course, which might connote qualities of independence and authority, for example, that have traditionally been associated with heteronormative masculinity. And you also note with regard to Le Playboys that Dutronc reinforces or reinscribes, I can't remember the word you used, normative constructions of masculinity. I wonder how you would reconcile this point with the point you bring in later that Philip also mentioned, that the dandy is always in opposition. I wonder if dandyism can also function as a sleight of hand in certain instances, like a diversion in the sense that dandyism allows a performer to create a discursive distance between himself and the norm, which obscures the ways in which heteronormativity is maintained or reinforced, for example.
One of the difficult tasks of making an assessment of Dutronc's performance in Le Playboys is that there is now a long span of time that has passed since he did that performance, and the way in which we perceive that today. I mean, you know, and you've written about this, how queerness becomes something that is actually normative in the past when it's presented in the present and so forth. And what I think is that there's a lot of double take going on in his performance. Let's not forget he was on the cusp of an enormous career as a film actor during the shooting of this video. And he has all the trappings of putting on these particular airs of playfulness, but at the same time indifference. And he's almost, in my interpretation, letting us know that he's playing at this, all right? And you could argue that's also a very normative way of actually displaying masculinity. So I am very willing to rotate this model of Dutronc and his masculinity around a little bit and look at it from different perspectives. But I would still say that there is this kind of disposition in the way in which he behaves himself and his mannerisms and everything that doesn't necessarily play into the archetypal, I would say, more classical masculinity of the time. I'm thinking about Serge Gainsbourg, and I'm thinking about, you know, some of the leading chanson singers. He is actually in opposition to that. And that's kind of how I would make an argument for making that statement on his forging of masculinity, by offsetting it against some of the other major icons in French culture during that time. Okay, and a lot comes back to the style of singing, the style, the genre, and so forth.
Thanks as much. In fact, the thing that I really wanted to pick up on was exactly that issue around the chanson icons, Jacques Brel, Charles Aznavour, Georges Brassens, and so on. That I mean, quite clearly, Dutronc is distanced from those artists musically. Evidently, you know, in terms of his physical style, I think that's quite right. But I wonder whether there are some alignments in terms of the performance of masculinity between Dutronc and these other icons. I was reading a really interesting article by Adeline Cordier on chanson and tacit misogyny. Mm-hmm. And you know, there are issues in there about the male domination of the genre and the sense in which chansonniers are sort of performing this authenticity, particularly through authorship. And of course, that is very different for Dutronc, who's not his own lyricist primarily. They're thinking of women in relation to male roles as mothers, as wives, as lovers. Prostitutes are sympathetic characters, but really only because of what they offer to the male psyche in that context. And I was looking then at the lyrics to some of the examples that you chose. So from the Playboy lines like, "I have a girl trap," or "girls fall to my knees." This was kind of interesting to me, thinking about whether actually in terms of the relationship to women, whether Dutronc is really so far from this kind of tacit misogyny of the chansonnier. I mean, I have another point about Frenchness as well, but I'll come back to that. Maybe you want to take
that. Just a very quick response to that. Believe me, I've been considering this the whole time. Not least in the mini video where he is actually positioned alongside his then wife Francoise Hardy, and there is actually this kind of tacit masculinity that we do have issues with going on, and I think this would actually be a very important chapter in a longer work on Jacques Dutronc, the way in which he appropriates, but at the same time screens those kinds of strategies of normativity and masculinity, and even in some cases misogyny.
Yeah, quite. Mm. So then I was sort of spinning off that then, again sort of thinking about some of the lyrics and thinking about his connection with Gainsbourg and the sort of
yes,
Gallic masculinity that that the chansonniers were performing, and of course Dutronc and Gainsbourg worked together then some years later on an album called Guerre et Paix, War and Farts, a play on war and peace, Guerre et Paix. Thinking about this kind of notion of maybe a sort of national identity, thinking about Gainsbourg's Aux Armes, etc., which completely sort of defuses something about the national anthem.
Yeah.
I just kind of wondered about this sort of, as Cordier puts it, this kind of myth of the left-wing intellectual that chanson sort of built up, and how Dutronc kind of fits into some of those myths of Gallicness.
Yeah, and I think this whole question on how French popular music has played out since the Second World War and its influences, and how gender and race and politics have taken a different course, in no means a more problematic course, but a different course than the rest of Europe has done, are central questions, and how we look at popular culture from that period. And as I was trying to do in this presentation, I was trying to link also what he was doing to Le Nouvel Vague, which was actually very concerned about emancipative issues, race issues, sexuality, and so forth. And it's kind of the probably the crux of my whole presentation today, is how do we analyze theatricality when it is actually there to entertain us and we can be moved by it, but we still have to learn how to ask the critical questions. So I'm kind of coming around to your point that I think these are very, very central to this debate on dandyism. And if we want to distinguish dandyism from the aesthete, which is also another very important issue in this whole question, how we classify and how we categorize, these waters have to be muddied.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you so much. I might turn then to the chat bar, which is over to my right. There's obviously several really marvelous questions coming in. I'll just read them out, if that's okay. Zachary James Bressler kicks us off with this one. He says, you've talked about the mix of Le Cactus as being staged as a live performance. The mix that we listened to seems to me to be possibly a more contemporary remaster, one piece of evidence being the stereo sound, and Zachary is guessing that the initial release would have been mono, yeah, or at least that the main mode of listening at the time would have been so. Certainly stereo sound impacts and increases the perception of liveness in some way. So is there a historical perspective on the mix presentation and music listening technology that's relevant here, in addition to the production technology? And he's also wondering if you would elaborate more on the concept of vocal costuming. So two things there about the stereo mix and vocal costuming.
Yeah, gladly. Thanks very much for that great question. My use of the term vocal costuming comes direct from Simon Frith's work, which I've acknowledged in all my writings as well. And I've tried to kind of dress that up in a number of different ways and theorize, you know, the whole notion of people putting on a costume when they actually decide which voice they're going to use. And we must remember that when any of us sing, we are actually making a decision as to how we sing and how we actually costume the voice. It's a huge area of research, and I kind of only touched on that there. So that's in a kind of very, very small nutshell, that's where I'm coming in from vocal costuming. The mix is incredibly interesting, and I actually did not say that it was a live performance. I said it came over for its time as live in its sound, and that is actually because of the way it was mixed. I've discussed this with Alan Moore and one of my other colleagues, Emil Krogerud, and actually Zach Bressler as well. It's very likely that everyone experienced the song in mono when it first came out, but then there has been obviously treatment of this over time. Okay, so how we hear it through these speakers today and in remixes and so forth is something different, but I do feel even for its time, it had a kind of live feel, which then again brings big questions linked to authenticity up, and whether, you know, the theatricality of the mix actually is part of what makes his persona what it is. You know, I mean, these are very, very big debates, and they need to be obviously chiseled away at quite a lot. But I've kind of started on that road a bit, you know?
That's great, thanks. So the next one, I'm actually going to sort of conflate two here, and it may be that actually Phil wants to come in on some of this. I know he's got quite a lot of knowledge on this area. The first question comes from Paul Jackson. How did Dutron maintain and continue his persona outside of his music performances? For example, his interview appearances, publicity photos, record sleeves, etc. And then Ab Gardner says, was he part of the Yeah Yeah movement? And if so, as you say, why is he not remembered as musicians like Francois Hardy and Johnny Hallyday? So I see sort of further below that Phil has also responded somewhat to that, but if either of you have thoughts on this kind of broader persona outside of music as well, that would be helpful.
Phil, if I could just come in with that last comment very, very quickly. He has been remembered. He has a huge cult following. Yeah. Almost everyone of his generation actually love him and, you know his songs. So I don't want to get that wrong in this presentation, but scholars have not given him the credit he should have had. But he's got a very, very strong cult following, and he will, in my view, always be remembered. But my previous point was that it's astonishing this has not been written about more in sort of popular music studies coming out of France. Paul, could you take the first
little bit? I mean, it's been a while for me, so but I have seen Dutron being interviewed on TV and participating in panel shows and stuff like that, and the persona is the same. And he's always got either a cigarette or a cigar in his mouth. Like on the album cover, he's got this big cigar. The album cover shot with a picture of him is shot from a low angle. He's got this massive cigar and this kind of really sort of sardonic look on his face is a pretty good representation of the persona. And you do see that persona all the time when he appears on television, on chat shows, when he's being interviewed. It's been too long since I've seen him in a film, so I can't speak to that right now. But it's certainly in terms of his kind of public presence in the media, it's very, very continuous with that figure that you've seen in the videos and the kind of attitude that he seems to project. And I do want to amplify what Stan said about, there is zero scholarship on Dutron, as far as I can tell. And given his indeed status within France, that's, at this point, kind of inexcusable. Of course, I don't know why French scholars aren't writing about him, but I also think that, I'm happy to be corrected if I've misunderstood something or I just haven't noticed something, but it seems to me that European rock, in the sense of French, Italian, Spanish, are pretty neglected areas, generally speaking. Obviously, Northern Europe has gotten a lot more attention in this respect than Southern Europe. And so I think there's a lot of work to be done in all of that, not just Dutron, but really the whole sort of phenomenon. And I also wanted to go back to the Frenchness for just a second and to hook that back up to what I was saying about the lyrics. I mean, one of the things that's interesting about these lyrics is that they're untranslatable, okay? They exist only in French. You cannot translate a song like Mini, Mini, Mini into any other language, right? Because it's entirely dependent on, well, on many things, not just the sort of wordplay or the specific words, although it's entirely dependent on those, but also, on the cadence of French, the scansion of French, all the sort of formal qualities of the language. To me, this is interesting because so much, sort of going back to that idea of Dutron as being, the first French artist, as opposed to one like Johnny Hallyday, who was, the French Elvis or whatever. That sort of creating these or singing these songs that are so French that you can't even translate them is kind of part of that, right? And a very stray thought that I had, again, I'm happy to be corrected, but I mean, it has sometimes been said, I'm not sure that I think this is true, but it has sometimes been said that, David Bowie was one of the first British performers to perform, in a sort of clearly British accent. Even the Beatles certainly subdued their Liverpudlian accents when singing, not when speaking, but when singing, right? And so Bowie is sometimes credited, not by me particularly, as being the first, sort of British rock star. And so there's got to be an interesting connection between Bowie and dandyism on the one hand and Dutron and dandyism on the other hand, and all of this is somehow to do with enabling someone to emerge as a distinct national type of, or a type of performer that acknowledges and foregrounds its nationality, as opposed to, suppressing that in favor of what at the time were primarily American models. And I also just wanted to go back one second to what Freya was saying before about those lyrics, because those lyrics to Late Playboy are, they're pretty embarrassing. I mean, they are horribly misogynistic in point of fact. But I am not trying to defend Lancement or Dutron in saying this, because there it is. But at the same time, I do think that it pays to look at how he performs those lyrics, because there's no sense of triumphalism in it. That's what I find really interesting. Another performer talking about this infallible girl trap that, forces women to his knees, he just kind of tosses it off, right? And he, especially the last line, not only does he toss it off, but Stan has talked about this, I don't remember it's in this presentation or the other one, about his use of that sort of weird crooning moment. Right, when he starts to talk about that, which is like, okay, so what's going on there? And then when he's talking about his device, his trap, he says, he gives sound effects. He says it makes three noises, cock, bang, boom, sorry, four, and u. Now, these are all very typical French vocal sound effects. But the last one, u, he doesn't say u, he says u, as if it were a horse, right? So it's like, what is going on here, right? And so I think that, yes, the lyrics are horribly misogynist, and the idea of it, you know, I don't care about these playboys, I'm not jealous of them because I've got this incredible device that gets me women, you know, okay, yeah, it's there. But at the same time, the way he delivers that part of it is very distanced through these vocal mannerisms, through this very kind of casual, almost tossed off way of saying it. I understand that that's open to multiple readings, right? I mean, you could certainly read that in terms of an extreme form of self-confident male dominance, or you could read it more in terms of a performer somewhat distancing himself from the very images that he's creating, right? And I'm not, you know, I'm not saying which is the way to go here, but I think that's, I'm just saying that I think that it doesn't work for me to look at the lyrics in isolation. You have to also consider how he's performing them and what the performed relationship of performer to what he's performing seems to be.
Thanks. Yeah, I'm just going to bring in another question, actually. I'm going to jump forward a little bit to Laurie Byrne's question, because it seems to me very related here. She writes, in keeping with what Phil has said about nonchalance in juxtaposition with anger, it's fun to listen to the delivery of oui, with, ouch, in Les Cactus. Everything in the world is poking at him like a cactus spindle. And she wonders, Stan, how you interpret the use of that linguistic utterance within a blues framework.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of a French inflection of a blues note, I would put it like that. And on that note, I'd also say that what was really interesting in the sonogram that Laurie did for me in, you know, that particular example was the sheer weight on that sort of moment. It kind of almost distorts when he sings that. So I think it's, I wouldn't want to say he's trying to imitate the blues, but he's doing a kind of impassioned French version of this, which actually to me comes over quite authentic. You know, I kind of buy that when he does it, because, well, it might be because I've listened to the track so many hundreds of times that I've actually got into it. But I think also the first time I encountered that, it just seemed to come from somewhere that felt sort of extremely passionate and, in fact, angry. And, you know, that song is all about, you know, fighting things in the world and not being able to sit down because you're going to get stung, you know. It's kind of full of metaphors and so forth. But I think that, you know, those shouts, those moments, those exclamation marks are incredibly loaded in signification. And that's kind of one of the things I was trying to excavate musicologically.
Mm. Great. Oh, go on, Kayana. Yeah, come in. Sorry, you're up in the top right-hand corner of my screen, so I keep not quite seeing you. Sorry.
Oh, that's good. Thanks. Great. I was just wondering if I could try to kind of pull together a few of the threads that have come up in the last few comments, because I've been thinking a little bit about theatricality, which is obviously one of the main points of your presentation, Stan. Mm. And I think that this relates to the topic that Philip talked about how Dutronc and Bowie have kind of become national symbols, in a sense, as dandies, you might say. So you talk about how theatricality has its etymological origin in Greek, to see, for theater. And we usually talk about theatricality in relation to visual phenomena. Mm. But, so I'm wondering if you could elaborate a little bit about how you understand the sonic theatricality or musical theatricality in sonic terms, because I think, as we've also been touching on, Philip talked about the horse-like vowels, that I think that the sonic theatricality is also a big part of the popularity and appeal of these performers. And I think the same can be said about Bowie as about Dutronc, I think. I know you've written about theatricality of glam rock, Philip, which is quite evident in costuming, artwork, and so on, but perhaps also in the production techniques and styles that emerged at the time. I'm thinking about Gus Dudgeon's work, for example, in using sonic means for emphasizing lyrical statements or creating sonic environments. that might be described as producing quite visceral or discernible, at least, theatrical effects.
Yeah, if that makes sense. I'll just give a very quick answer to that. And that's that my definition of theatricality in this presentation was through the musical persona. I use that as my kind of platform for launching into these, you know, very multifarious discussions on what's going on in sort of the voice when it becomes theatricalized. So I really liked one of Simon Zagorski Thomas's comments, which I think I just glimpsed when it was coming through, and that was how the audiovisual display of Dutron is actually not necessarily as powerful or as emphatic as his singing is. But the interesting thing is that when you see the video, the sound actually compensates for that, I feel, and actually theatricalizes those movements into something they actually are not when you just look at them without the sound. And I was trying to, in my presentation, also turn the sound off at a few moments to demonstrate these points of what happens when sound and singing becomes theatricalized. It does actually take on this kind of musical persona element.
That's fantastic, thanks. So one more over here. It's another combo. It's a Steve Waxman, Sarah Hill double bill. Steve points out that Sarah had raised the question of how national context might shape the way that we interpret matters of gender and performance as we see into Trump's persona. Sarah had asked how you calibrate masculinity across national and cultural context. Steve then goes on to say that he thinks this matters in relation to the way that pop and rock are understood. In the US and the UK, this is the moment where rock is breaking away from pop and defining an authenticity of its own to a degree. Dutronc seems to be occupying a space that, in a sense, refuses this sense of a break. He embodies qualities that I think we would read as more pop, even though he is using aspects of rock aesthetics. And that seems pertinent to the particular sort of dandyism that he puts forth. Steve therefore wonders whether you could comment further on how rock and pop might be used to frame this consideration of Dutronc's persona. And of course, that goes back to Sarah's question of national context.
Okay, I can just quickly say something about the national context. I think it makes all the difference understanding the context in which identities and genders are, as I've used this term, calibrated. And you would raise a question. I'm very happy you came up with that, because I do have this statement that theatricality is a recalibration of everyday life. And by that, I was actually meaning it's a reset, a refresh, or even a kickstart to the way in which our identities are already finely tuned. And I think to excavate that, we definitely have to take into account not only the role of nationality, but also transnationality and the way in which music, even, you know, crossing over a small channel of water from one metropolitan to the next, actually does demand this readjustment on the part of us as analysts. So that's a kind of very short answer, but I would love to have a longer conversation about this.
Thanks so much. And I think then we may have time for one final question, which was from Simon, who says, how do you think that the French cabaret tradition relates to this aesthetic? It reminds Simon of the way that some Polish rock uses performance and lyrics, and it's a strong tradition there too. So going back, I guess, not just to chanson, but to the sort of original round of chanson in the French cabaret period. Don't know if you have anything to say about that.
Phil, do you have anything to say on that? I kind of feel that there are very strong connections here. I know that Dutron was, or has been, kind of classified as being post yeah, because there was this very strong yeah movement, and this was also connected to the French chanson whole genre, plus cabaret fills into this. So I would say that that would be subject for another paper. that you could actually draw the lines between sort of cabaret traditions and what goes on literally on stage in some of Dutron's performances. That's just a sort of off the top of my head reaction there. Mm.
Yeah, I think there is probably some connection between that kind of, you know, cigarette smoking, nonchalant persona or disengaged persona that is traceable to cabaret. Mm-hmm. I also think, though, I mean, I'd have to think more about this and try to work it out, but my suspicion is that for Dutron, cabaret is more a point of reference than something that he is part of, if you understand what I'm saying, that he invokes it, but I'm not sure he really is of it, right? And that might be true of his relationship to rock as well, right? That he sort of invokes rock, but it's not entirely clear what his relationship is to it. To go back to the question of rock and pop, though, I'm not sure these are actually categories in France. I mean, rock is, and yeah, but I'm not sure that pop, rock and pop in the sense of rock versus pop is meaningful in French culture or was meaningful in the 60s in French culture. I'm not saying I know the answer to this question. I'm posing it as a question because it seems to me that to look at Dutron in terms of, you know, a binary or an opposition or whatever of rock versus pop, would, if that wasn't part of French culture at the time, which I kind of think it wasn't, but as I say, you know, that requires more investigation, then that would be really sort of imposing, you know, a US-UK perspective on this, rather than looking at it more in its own terms, in terms of, you know, what the music culture of France was like and what the discourses within that culture were. I was actually in France at the time. I was pretty young. But I don't recall certainly this kind of emergent distinction between pop and rock that became so important in the English speaking world. But it's a really interesting question. It's certainly one that's worth looking into more carefully, along with so many other things.
Mm-hmm. Yes, indeed. I mean, I was thinking also that actually the cabaret line might lead more obviously to Brel and Aznavour and the Chansonnier, yeah. Rather than and then by way of a kind of slightly squiffy angle to Dutronc. So that, I mean, that's definitely a paper that I'm signing up to hear, whoever wants to write it. That's great. Well, I think that is probably it for now. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Simon, for having us all along. Thank you, Stan, for a fantastic presentation. Thank you, Phil and Kayana, for your input. And jolly good. Well done, everybody.
Yeah, no, that's thanks. That's fantastic. And yes, and thanks, Freya, for taking the chair. Great. It appears that the concert has been cancelled due to technical difficulties immediately afterwards. So we're pretty much done for today. But I'd just like to remind you that on Thursday at 6, you've got the going back to cabaret. We've got the Copla Cabaret, which is inspired from the Spanish Copla tradition. So it sort of draws from another European cabaret tradition. Alejandro's paper you can see in whatever it is, 2 hours time at the 9:30 when the papers go live, and then you can come along and view his performance and join into a discussion afterwards on Thursday at 6. And then Alex, do you want to jump in and just say anything about the Friday session? Are you here still, Alex? You were here a little while ago, but I can't see you.
Sarah tells us that Alex has gone.
Oh, okay. All right.
Well, that confirmed.
Great. Okay. Anyway, I'll be sending out the Zoom invites for both of those things for later in the week. And obviously, you've got the papers coming. There are 6, I think, papers this week that a really interesting range of things. I've not seen them all yet, but I've seen a couple of them so far. And as I say, they go live in a couple of hours. thanks again, everybody. It's been great. It's been really, really, really interesting. My wife was sitting in the background going, wow, this is really cool. So, and she's really not a popular music scholar. So if you can make someone who's not interested in popular music interested, then, you know, there you go. What can I say but gee. All right.
Thanks, guys.
Okay, thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Great. Okay, I'm going to stop the recording now, which doesn't mean that we're thrown out, but it means that the recording stopped.
Now we can say what we really think.
Yeah, we can say what we really think, Simon.
It's not being captured.
Thanks very much, everyone.
Oh, actually, no, because YouTube Live's still on. Let me.
No.